A warm welcome everyone to our online memorial service for St Mary's at Unstone. There'll be words on the screen to join in with, music to listen to, and also a time to light a candle to remember your loved ones whose memory will be burning brightly in your hearts and minds today. The candle also reminds us of the light of Christ, a light no darkness can quench. A light which is with us now and always. So do light your candle at home at the appropriate time. Let us begin in prayer. Lord God, as we are gathered, we are assured that Jesus is here to support us and bring comfort and peace as we remember loved ones departed. May we remember all gone before us and the love they shared with us, and that their memories continue to shine brightly in our lives. Lift our hearts in hope that they are safe with you in a place described as paradise through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you, Paul. For any that don't know, I'm Peter Bold, a team rector. As Paul said, I'm now going to light a candle. And if you have one, then you might like to light one with me. A candle, always a sign of hope, a reminder that God is with us, that Jesus is risen from the dead. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. A reminder of Jesus's promise that he offers to each one of us eternal life. So you might like to pray with me. Jesus, you are the light of the world, a light that no darkness can quench. Upon your church, wrestling with the darkness of evil, battling against doubt, let your light shine. Upon the world governments, facing gloom and despair, battling against disaster, let your light shine. Upon those that live in the shadows, caught up in sorrow and strife, struggling against oblivion, let your light shine.
Jesus, your spirit is risen to the grave. The But on the first day of the week, at early dawn, they came to the tomb, taking the spices that they had prepared. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they went in, they did not find the body. While they were perplexed about this, suddenly two men in dazzling clothes stood beside them. The women were terrified and bowed their faces to the ground. But the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here, but has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still in Galilee that the Son of Man must be handed over to sinners and be crucified and on the third day rise again." Then they remembered his words.
As we meet together tonight, I guess we will all come with a number of different emotions. I'm sure nearly all of you come with very good memories, memories of wonderful times you've spent with someone who has now died. You'll come remembering the love they've shown, the joy they've given. We come remembering perhaps some of their odd habits, things that make them unique, things that make them smile. But of course, we also come with loss, sadness, perhaps loneliness or anger. Life cannot be the same. Some of those who have died have been over 90 and have lived wonderfully full and long lives. But it's still hard to be without them. Others have had their lives cut short, dying so much younger than you would expect, and it seems so unfair. In this last year, I have taken two particularly tragic funerals, one for my colleague Carolyn, and one for a young mother. And we've had funerals during lockdown, where people couldn't say goodbye as they would have liked, where so many family just couldn't come to the service. It's been a hard year, and I have no answers as to why God allows it. We can only say we're sorry and support and pray and care for one another as best we can. So we do meet tonight to remember before God those we have loved, to give thanks for the good memories, to pray for one another in our sadness. The women in the reading we've just heard were doing something very similar. The passage took place just after Jesus's death on a cross, when Jesus was probably just 33 years old. The women had known Jesus for some time, perhaps 3 years, perhaps all 33 years of his life. They came to the tomb. The women coming to the tomb probably included Mary, Jesus's mother, and maybe Jesus's sisters. The women had loved him. They thought of him as the most amazing, wonderful, special man who had ever lived. Their lives had become bound up with his. He brought healing and joy to many beyond their wildest expectations. But they had then seen him killed by the authorities. The jealousy of the chief priests and the corruption of the officials ended in his death. No doubt those women could not believe it. They would have been devastated and angry. It wasn't fair. And so, in their devastation, on that first Easter day, they come to his grave to honour him and his memory. I guess they simply felt that they had to do something. So they came to anoint him, a bit like we might bring flowers to a grave. We with them come in sadness to honour those we have loved and still love who are no longer with us. But for those women in the gospel, an extraordinary thing happened. It's easy to forget the shock because we've heard the story so often. Easy to forget how devastated they would have been, because we know what happens next. They came to the tomb and found it empty. I can't imagine how they felt, but then into their darkness, two angels appeared. They declared, "Why do you look for the living amongst the dead? He is not here. He is risen." Why do you look for the living among the dead? When I first thought about using this reading at a memorial service a good few years ago, I thought it wasn't fair. None of you have gone to a funeral and had it cancelled because your beloved have come back to life. It was all right for Jesus's friends, Jesus's family, but not for you. But then I remembered my gran's funeral, one of the first funerals I went to. When we lowered her body into the ground, it struck me that I was lowering an empty shell, an empty tomb into the ground. Gran was no longer there. She had gone. She had risen. As Jesus said, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, so that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life." So perhaps, if I may, I'd like to play the role of one of those angels tonight and remind you of those words. We shouldn't look for the living among the empty shells. They are risen. Billy Graham said that if anyone heard that he was dead, they shouldn't believe it. It was not true. He would not be dead. He would have only changed his address. Number 6, Pearly Gates Street. That does not take away the pain. I still miss my grandparents and my mum. I miss my colleague and friend Carolyn. I miss many friends and family members who've died. The pain of losing a husband or a wife or a son or a daughter is obviously so much greater. Mary and the rest of the women still, in the end, had to live, well, the vast majority of their earthly lives without the physical presence of Jesus. He appeared to them briefly, but he didn't stay. But the disciples didn't go back to fishing. Meeting Jesus risen from the dead transformed their whole view of life. Death had lost its sting. The grave had lost its victory. I can't think of any reason for the church starting other than that Jesus really did rise from the dead. That doesn't mean we should scrap memorial service. It's important to honour and remember all that our loved ones have meant to us as they've lived with us. It is good and natural to cherish photographs and visit graves, to keep those memories strong and living in our hearts and minds. We do that for Jesus. We treasure the memories of what he did on earth before he died. But we also remember that he did not stay dead. He ascended before us to be in heaven and prepare a place for each one of us when we die. I hope that you can share with me that same hope that I have for my mum, my grandparents, Carolyn, and so many others. I do remember and honour their lives. Their deaths brought great sadness. I miss them. But their deaths were not the end, but a new beginning. They are no longer here. They are risen. And one day we will meet again. Amen.
Thank you.
So, as we prepare to remember the names, the people we have loved and still love, we start by praying with Christians throughout the world. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. And so, we remember before God those who have died. And as we do so, we give thanks for their lives and pray for their families and all who mourn. You might find it helpful to look at your own candle, if you have one, a reminder of God's presence with us, light in the darkness, hope that is steadfast and certain. That our loved ones are fine, and that one day we can meet again.
Thank you.
So we say together, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil. For you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, and my cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Father God, we pray for your world. We thank you for all that is good, for sunrise, animals and plants, for food and drink. But more than that, we thank you for those we share these things with. We thank you for the community in which we live, for those people who we share our life, be it in just a familiar hello or a close friendship. We pray for this world, that together we would steward and safeguard it so that it can continue to be enjoyed with others. That we will care for the plants and animals and the environment. We pray for all those throughout the world who suffer loss, for areas of war that you would bring peace, for famines to be replaced with plenty, drought with water, persecution with human compassion. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Jesus, we pray for our country, that like you we would be able to walk this world with a presence that brings peace, challenge, and encouragement to all we meet. We pray that we, like you, would encourage a radical sense of care for the others, that we would be helping people to see that throwing stones is no good. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Holy Spirit, surround us and all who mourn this day with your continuing compassion. Do not let grief overwhelm your children or turn them against you. When grief seems never ending, take them one step at a time along your road of death and resurrection. In Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
thank you for joining us all for this online memorial service from the Dronfield with Holmesfield team ministry and churches together in Dronfield and District. We end now with a blessing, a Celtic blessing. So may you have walls for the wind and a roof for the rain, and drinks beside the fire, laughter to cheer you, and those you love near you, and all that your hearts may desire. Remember your loved ones with fondness and with joy, for the hope of heaven is within our reach through Jesus Christ our Lord. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you and those you love this day and always. Amen.